Good morning, dear students. Welcome to another session of microwave and antenna. So in the previous session, we discussed regarding what is the range of microwave frequencies, what is the frequency band which is present over there, and how they are divided, say based on IEEE, how the division happens, based on the US military concepts, how the old and new bands were specified. Then we discussed what does a microwave system consists of. Then we had few other discussion like what are the different microwave devices, what are its applications. So these are the things we had discussed in the previous session. So in coming fourth session, we'll start off our discussion with respect to the microwave transmission lines. So prior going into these microwave transmission lines, we have to deal some of the aspects related to the transmission lines, which will be helpful for us in the coming fourth derivations. So we'll be looking forward for that point, and then we'll be moving ahead with the derivation part. In previous session also I have discussed this, so this is like a recap, but we'll be discussing regarding these aspects in this session. So as we had discussed, that microwave frequency falls in the range of 1 to 300 gigahertz. And when we speak of, say, when we talk about the wavelength, right, it falls in the range of, say, some 30 centimeter to 1 millimeter in terms of wavelength. So that discussion we had in the previous session. So another point which comes around is, what is the length of the transmission line we have to consider? So how is the length affected? So that is what we have to look out for. Just give me a second. So how does the length play a vital role when we are considering microwave frequencies? So now so when we look at the length, right, when we consider frequencies which are very low as compared to the microwave frequencies, that is, we had discussed in one of the points. So here, so when we consider frequency, say it is in the range of, say, 1 kilohertz, which is very much less compared to your microwave frequencies. Your microwave frequency, say it is in the range of, say, 1 gigahertz. It is in the range of 1 gigahertz. Now we know that lambda is given by C by F. So where C is the speed of the light and F is the frequency at which you are operating. So here, if I assume that it is a vacuum, then it will be 3 into 10 raised to 8 meters per second. And here I have 1K, where it is 1 into 10 raised to 3. So when I consider this, what I'll be having, I'll be having 3 into 10 raised to 8 minus 3, which will be 5. So which will be meters. So lambda value will be in the range of 3 into 10 raised to 5 meters when you're operating, say, in 1 kilohertz. Now, generally, when you have any transmission line, right, any transmission line, so it cannot continuously, when I place it, it cannot be this much in its length. So it will be very much limited. So when I consider the length of the transmission line, the length of the transmission line will be very much less than lambda when you're operating at very low frequencies. Now, this is the reason why you apply the lumped theory. That is, lumped, you make use of the term as lumped network, and you apply the network theory concepts. That is, you apply KVL, KCL, that is, you represent something in this form. So there is a voltage source. So what you're doing is you're applying directly KVL, KCL, and then you're obtaining. So this is your entire circuit which is present. Say it is operating at 1 kilohertz. So here what happens is this, say R value, it will be given as say 1 ohm. So this might be 2 ohm. But when we come to microwave frequency range, right, what happens is, say it is 1 gigahertz. If I try to estimate the wavelength, so what I'll be getting is 3 × 10⁸ divided by 1 × giga is 10⁹. So when I estimate this, what I'll be getting is 3 × 10⁻¹. So lambda will be in the range of 0.3 meters, or you just convert this into centimeter, it will be 30 cm. So lambda will be in this range. So generally when you consider your circuit, when you're trying to transmit the, transmit the signal from one end to the other end, the transmission line won't be just 30 cm. So in this case, what happens is the length of the transmission line will be very much greater than this wavelength. So length, just it cannot be 30 cm. Length might be say 1 meter. So when it is 1 meter, when I consider 1 meter, 1 meter is very much greater than 30 cm. So this is just an example what we are considering. So under this condition, what happens is you cannot apply the lumped network concepts directly to the transmission lines. So what you do is, you consider the transmission line and you divide this transmission line, assuming that this is one lumped network, this is one lumped network. So why this is being done is, and now whenever we have say transmission lines, we will be dealing with resistances, inductances, conductances, capacitances. So even in lumped networks also you come across these. So here what happens is, in this case, these all parameters we consider as distributed over this transmission lines, because the length of the transmission line is very much greater than the lambda value when you're dealing with microwave frequencies. So therefore, what we have to do, we have to consider what is called as, distributed circuit theory. We consider distributed circuit theory. What does this imply? These RLGC components which are there, they will be considered as, they'll be assumed that they are distributed over this entire transmission line. And then what we do is we apply KVL, KCL to this one part, and then we consider the overall result. So that's why the length of the transmission line will play a vital role when we are dealing with different kinds of frequencies. So here it is non-microwave, here it is a microwave frequencies. So for frequencies less than microwave range, what happens is the length of the transmission line is very much less than lambda, whereas the length of the transmission line for microwave frequencies is very much greater than lambda. So because of which we apply the distributed circuit theory concept, and we assume that the distribution is uniform. That is, RLGC are uniformly distributed. Now, since this thing comes over here, this concept, what happens is these will not be specified directly just in ohm as we are doing here, 1 ohm, 2 ohm. So it will be like, for example, resistance will be specified in ohm per meter. Conductance will be specified in mho per meter. Then your inductance will be specified in Henry per meter. And conductance will be specified in farad per meter. Whereas in this case, what they'll be specifying, if capacitance is there, it will be specified in farads only. If inductance is there, it will be specified in Henry. then if conductance is there, it will be specified in mho or in siemens. So this is how it goes around. Okay, so therefore this concept plays a vital role when you are considering the microwave frequencies. So that is what they have discussed over here. So here we can observe a few things. What he specifies, length is very much less than lambda for the transmission lines which are operating at very low frequencies. So in this case, what happens is the losses are considered, that is the transmission line losses are considered to be negligent. So negligent, the losses are identified based on the resistance and the conductances. So these can be considered as zero over the transmission line. That is, in previous this thing, we are just writing, suppose we have a transmission line. So what happens is, we have a transmission line. We have, say, a resistance element connected over here. So here, this part also has some resistance. So this also gives rise to some losses. So in low frequency, this thing, what happens is the length of the transmission line is very much lesser than the lambda, due to which what happens is the losses are considered to be negligent. That is, the resistance and the conductances are assumed to be negligent. But when we go for microwave frequencies, right, we cannot neglect these resistances and capacitances which are distributed throughout the transmission line. So that is what does this specify. So he has specified an example over here, in which you can just check over here. You have actually a voltage generator. It is not microwave. It does not generate in the microwave range. So you have a generator which is generating in below microwave range. Then you have a transmission line which is present, and then you have the load over here. Now this transmission line, what I consider based on the signal, say 1 kilohertz, if I'm considering, the length will be very much less than the wavelength. Wavelength was around 30 kilometers or 3 into 10 raised to 5 meters. So which is around 300 kilometers. 300 kilometers or 30 kilometers. It will be around 30 kilometers. So you cannot have a transmission line which is 30 kilometers in its continuous length. So if you consider this one, the length of the transmission line is very much lesser than the wavelength. When we estimate it, so here is an example which they have given. So if that is the case for 10 kilohertz, if you just consider, it is 30 kilometers. So therefore, what we have, the length of the transmission line is very much lesser than the wavelength. So under these conditions, what happens is the losses of the transmission lines can be negligent. So in short, what they specify is there are no losses in the transmission lines when we are operating in the low frequency range. But what happens to the circuit or the transmission lines when we are operating in microwave range? So in that case, the length of the transmission line will be very much greater than the operating wavelength, that is wavelength of the microwave signal. So that is what we had checked out in the previous case. So when we are dealing with the microwave transmission lines, right, we discussed that we have to look out for distributed circuit theory, and also we have to look out for some Maxwell's field equations, wherein we'll be considering the operating conditions, and we'll try to estimate some of the parameters, say such as the voltage reflection coefficient, transmission coefficient. We can estimate the other parameters, that is alpha and beta, that is attenuation. So these all things we'll be able to estimate. So here what we do is we look out for uniform distributed circuit theory, which is nothing but you're applying KVL and KCL itself. That is whatever conditions you apply for lumped networks, right? You consider those things and you apply it to the other networks. So that is what you look out for. So before prior going to into that part, right, we have some of the basic concepts which we'll be utilizing in the derivations. So that we'll be discussing in this part now. So here, say we have a microwave source which is generating a frequency in the range of say 1 gigahertz to 300 gigahertz. So this is the generator impedance. You have a load which we have shown, and in between you'll be having the transmission line. So the signal has to move from the source towards the load. Now, in this case, what we have is this transmission line, what we are considering. As we know that transmission line here in this case, what happens is as we have transmission line length is very much lesser than lambda when we are operating at microwave frequencies. Therefore, what we have to do is we have to apply the uniform distributed circuit theory. So when we are applying that, what happens is when you have a transmission line, you have to divide this transmission line. You are assuming that these resistances, conductance, then say inductance and capacitance, these are distributed uniformly for each of these parts. So here, 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 they are uniformly distributed. So when we consider that, so what are the parameters we have to look out for? So when we look into these aspects, right, we represent the transmission line. That is, we consider a delta amount of this transmission line. Say this is the length of the transmission line. So in this one, I just consider a delta amount of the transmission line. Say if I'm assuming that it is placed on the Z axis. So I'll be considering just a delta amount of this transmission line. So once I consider the delta amount of this transmission line, so this is how the distributed circuit parameters might look out. So I'll consider any one. Say I'll consider this one. So what will happen in this case, I'll be having R, that is resistance, inductance, which will be in series, conductance and capacitances will be parallel. That is, they'll be present in between the lines. This will be present along the lines. Resistance and inductances will be present along the lines, and capacitance and conductance will be present between the lines. Now, as I mentioned that these values, what you're specifying will be in per meter. So resistance is there, it will be ohm per meter. Length is there, length will be in Henry per meter. Capacitance is there, it will be in farad per meter. And conductance is there, it will be in mho per meter. So here, this transmission line will be represented with this equivalent circuit representation. So this is how the line will be appearing. So that is this part what you're considering. Say the length of this one is delta Z. So this is how it will be appearing. So this is resistance, this is inductance, this is capacitance, and this, this is conductance, this is capacitance. Now, what happens is, since I'm just considering only delta Z. So if I want the actual value of this resistance, I have to multiply. You see that it is ohm per meter. So here, what is the length of this one? It is delta Z. So if I want to know the exact value of this one, what I'll be doing is, I'll be taking this one and multiplying it with delta Z. So delta Z is in say meters. So if this is in ohm per meter, and if I multiply it with the length parameter meter, so SI unit of meter and meter gets cancelled, and what is remaining? Only ohms is remaining. So similarly for the others. Therefore, you have R into delta Z, L into delta Z, C into delta Z, and G into delta Z. So that's why this is how the distributed network will be represented. So this you will be having n number of elements, that is say one here, second here, so on up to n. That is, you have distributed this. So here also I'll be having r into delta z. I'll be dividing this into delta z this thing, and then I'll be using this. So here l into the delta z value and so on. So here also I'll be having I'll be representing it as resistance, inductance, then I'll be having a the conductance, then the capacitance, and then I continue. So this is how it will be represented. So this is how the transmission lines will be represented in its circuit form. So this is one part of that distributed network. So now if I analyze one of these parts, then I'll be able to estimate the different parameters of the entire transmission line. So that is what they have specified. We are applying the distributed circuit theory, the resistances will be specified in ohm per meter, Henry per meter, mho per meter, or Siemens per meter, and capacitance is in farad per meter. So here if you just observe that all these four parameters are actually function of the length of the transmission line what we are considering. So this is the first point what we have to look out when we are analyzing the transmission line at microwave frequency. You have to identify, say, the impedance of this one and impedance of this one. So you should know how to get the overall impedance or admittance. So your impedance, we represent it as Z, and admittance is Y. So this one, if I know admittance, I can obtain it from the other point. If I know the impedance, I can obtain it in this one. So this is how I can obtain the impedance and admittances. Now, since these are in series, right, obtaining impedance is a good point. And since these are in parallel, right, obtaining the admittance is a better point. So here what we have, so if I want to know what is the line impedance in this case, so how it will be given? It will be given by a resistance plus the impedance of this part, plus the impedance of this one. So how it is represented? It is represented as Z is equal to R plus J XL, where XL is the impedance of this part. XL is representing the impedance of this part. And what is the value of XL? That is impedance of this inductor, what we are considering, it is given by omega L. It is given by omega into L, and where omega is equal to 2 pi times F. So therefore, impedance of the transmission line will be equal to Z is equal to R plus J omega L. That is, impedance of this transmission line will be represented with R plus J omega L. Now coming down to the admittance, how do I obtain the overall admittance of the transmission line? It will be G plus the impedance of this one. Since it is admittance, parallel will be represented with addition now, this one. So the conductance value plus the impedance value of this capacitance, so which is given by what? Which is given by XC is equal to 1 by omega C. So here when we are using capacitance, right, just be careful, because this is how it will be represented, because I am taking it as this is inverted version of R, that is one G is equal to 1 by R, and this one we'll be considering it as 1 by minus JXC, so which will be represented as J omega C. So that is how it comes around. So here we have Y is represented by G plus J omega C. So that is, we are considering admittance of, we are considering admittance related to this one plus admittance related to this one. So when we are considering impedance, right, we have to take it 1 by admittance of the other parameter divided by the when we're considering the resistance and the impedance, right? So we'll be taking it as y is equal to 1 by r plus 1 by j omega c. So that is how we consider this parameter. So you should be careful when you're using this parallel circuit over here. So this is with respect to the line impedance and line admittance. So here we have line impedance, which is given by R plus J omega L, and line admittance, which is given by J plus J omega C. So this will be in terms of ohm, and this will be in terms of mho or siemen. So moving further, we have come across a few of the terms in your network theory also, that how do I obtain characteristic impedance? If I know the line admittance and line impedance, right, then I'll be able to obtain the characteristic impedance, which will be given by square root of characteristic impedance, the line impedance divided by the line admittance, which is given by this equation over here. So if you replace R and Z and Y, right, you'll be getting Z naught, that is characteristic impedance of the line, is given by square root of R plus J omega L divided by G plus J omega C. So this is with respect to characteristic impedance. If I want the characteristic admittance, I just take 1 by Z naught, which will be equal to Y naught. Now we come across a few other concepts, that is what is meant by matched termination line. So in this case, the impedance of the load, if it is equivalent to the characteristic impedance of the transmission line, then we call such transmission line to be matched transmission line. That is, load impedance is equal to the characteristic impedance of the transmission line. So under this case, we have the matched transmission line. And when we have a matched condition, right, maximum power transfer happens. Maximum power transfer happens. And this leads to very less reflection or almost no reflections at all. Now, what does mismatch imply? That is load mismatch. So in this case, if the load impedance is not equivalent to the characteristic impedance of the transmission line, then we call this transmission line as mismatched transmission line. So whenever there is a mismatch, what happens is you come across the concepts which is called as incident and reflected waves. So in this case, what happens is, suppose you have the transmission line, and in this case, ZL is not equal to Z naught. So what happens is you'll be having an incident wave. This is the concept which comes because of the microwaves. So when microwaves hit the load, that is they reach the load, if there is a mismatch, what happens is there will be reflection of voltages happening, voltage and the currents which are happening, which we represent it as, this is the incident wave and this is the reflected wave. Due to these two, right, there will be interaction between the incident and the reflected waves. So this concept, again, it will be coming later. There will be discussing these in detail. So here we have the incident and the reflected wave. But at low frequency, what happens is these incident and reflected waves do not play a major role. Reflected waves are almost negligent at low frequencies. But at high frequencies, what happens is we have to look out for these parameters. We have to look out for these parameters, that is the incident and the reflected waves. So here, if there is a mismatch in the load, right, that is if ZL is not equal to the characteristic impedance of the transmission line, then reflection will be huge enough, and that may lead to some standing wave waves in the transmission line. So that again is a later point discussion. So due to this, what happens is reflections will be occurring in the transmission line. When there is a mismatch in the load, reflections are possible.